I was born to Doug and Teresa McMullen on February 19, 1972, in Cadillac, Michigan. I was the oldest of three, with a brother Phil and a sister Sarah. My childhood revolved around playing sports of some kind. I loved competition. My gift for running was discovered in football practice in seventh grade, when we would run around the field for conditioning. I was slow to mature physically, and my knees hurt from Osgood Slaughter's, a growing disorder that leaves the knees swollen and sore after exercise.
Sixth place, James Siraki, Grand Rapids Northview. Fifth place, Pat Nicholson, Clawson.
After sitting out of sports in the spring of my freshman year of high school, I experienced defeat after defeat by a runner on my own team a year younger than I. In football, it was my dream to play at the collegiate level. It was the perfect outlet for a late bloomer to establish his confidence on the field of battle. I love defense and returning kickoffs. Football left me frustrated, and I didn't have the stats college recruiters could see. Only heart and intensity. My final year of track, I improved and changed the way I measured success. I went from measuring myself on my team, to my conference, to my region, and to my state. I went to Eastern Michigan on recruiting visit, and Coach Park said for me to get a small scholarship to his program, I would have to win a state championship and place high in two other events. I left with his autograph because I thought it might be the last time I meet him. Welcome to the planet. Leading up to the state meet, my senior year, I was given my favorite quote, "The making of a champion. Today I gave all I had. What I've kept is lost forever." It has stayed with me my entire career. And to prove I had what it took when it really counted. Like Coach Parks promised, I received a $600 scholarship. I found out even state champions were construction to help pay for college in the summers. I was a chubby round peg jammed into a square hole at first. I looked like a football player that had accidentally got lost. I hadn't run over 5 miles in my life. And day one of cross-country practice, we ran 14. Eastern Michigan is an NCAA Division I powerhouse in track, and I quickly ended up at the back of the pack. Redshirting is kind of like a timeout for freshmen that are unable to contribute to the team. They're not issued uniforms, and it was one full year being at Eastern Michigan before I was able to put on my green and yellow jersey.
Followed by his teammate Chris
at the Central Collegiate Conference Championships at Notre Dame, I began to become an underdog of sorts in an EMU uniform. Coach Parks fudged my entry time by 5 seconds to get me in the fast heat with all of the best milers from the Big Ten. I did not disappoint and made my first major breakthrough and beat the best from the likes of Michigan, Michigan State, and Notre Dame in a big upset in the 1500 meter. 1992 was the year it all made sense when I watched a commercial for the 1992 Olympic Games and decided this is what I wanted to do with my life. I called my grandfather and told him the news, and he responded with a supportive, There's a winner. Mother. I was part of an international team of champions. We were all united under the charismatic Bob Parks. We had many victories and oftentimes only lost to members of our own team. We supported each other as we all reached for our dreams. During the years of 1990 and 1995, I accumulated 8 NCAA Division I All-American certificates, and more importantly, learned about loyalty, tradition, and commitment. It was the perfect environment for my dream of going to the Olympics to begin and the reality of the work to be understood.
Take him apart! Take him! Woo-hoo! Chew a gator! Way to go! That's what we need! Come on, Greg! Now go! Way to get that lead, Paul!
147.6.
Way to go, guys.
My agent, Ray Flynn, got me the best possible deal leaving college. I signed with ASICS Shoes just before the U.S. Championships to maximize the opportunity to make a living at my new job, running the mile under 4 minutes.
Has matched it at least once. The man in third you mentioned from Cadillac High School in Michigan, he went black in the shades, and Terrence Harrington, number 330. He has a powerful...
The 1995 U.S. Championships was my debut as a professional. I was a rookie running with the big boys. These guys were seasoned veterans that had seen action in the Olympics and World Championship events. I took the lead early in the race, and then the favorite, Steve Holman, took the lead, and I was boxed in until the final stretch. Steve moved to lane two as we began to sprint for the finish. I poured on the effort and leaned at the line. I actually tied Brian Hyde to the 1/100 of a second. But when they looked at the picture, I had won by an inch. The race was a huge win, and it kicked off my career as a professional in the best possible way.
Can he find a race someplace and get himself qualified?
Hey, Paul, you've got 338 as a qualifying standard, but your best time is 338.7. What are you planning on doing, and can you get that qualifying standard for Sweden?
I sure can. I can't wait to go over to Europe, get me in a fast race, or a fast time trial. I'm real excited about it. I know I can do it.
All right, we'll be looking for you there in Gothenburg, and we're looking for you also to get that standard. Brent?
Great. Thanks a lot.
All right. I love that confidence of that young man. Just get me on that 747, and let's get it done. And
worldwide long, efficient trains have
After winning the 1995 U.S. Championships, I had little time to celebrate, as I went to Europe to achieve the qualifying standard of 338.00. In only my second race, held in Lausanne, Switzerland, I ran exactly 338.00. It was a huge relief and allowed me to prepare for the World Championships 4 weeks later. Once at the World Championships in Gothenburg, Sweden, I had to first overcome getting hit in the chest with someone's forearm in the prelims, and then in the semis, tripped over two guys who fell right in front of me with 450 meters to go. Once in the final, I went right to the front where I was less likely to go down. I found out what the next level was when the world record holder, Nordin Morselli, took control of the race and never looked back. I finished 10th. My career was off to a running start. The 1995 rookie season produced a national championship and a top 10 world championship finish in Gothenburg, Sweden. The Olympic trials are uniquely nerve-wracking, as you must be at your peak mentally and physically on one day for 3 minutes and 40 seconds to achieve the right to be called an Olympian. My gesture to Steve Holman was not cool and had to do with some behind-the-scenes grievances I had with my federation. I have since publicly apologized to Steve for my gesture. The 1500 meter was contested in 113 degree heat in Atlanta, Georgia. Let's watch how the story unfolded.
And the runners take their mark.
You know, speaking of pushing it, McMullen, who we got a shot of there, is a big athlete, used to play tight end in high school, and really only became a national and world-class runner when he shed some of his muscle and weight that he put on to be a football player. He's not afraid to get physical out there.
And obviously, think of all that. How did that experience go? Half an hour later, he was still telling us about how important it was to he and his career. Michael Cox has the lead. McMullen is second. Jason.
That McMullen might make. And really, all they're now doing is getting into position for the last lap sprint.
McMullen now edges ahead. Pires second. Holman third. Sorensen continues to gain in fourth. Ed Netto is fifth.
McMullen looking very good out in the lead, and Pyra running an outstanding race as Holman looks as if he's not going to be able to do it, and the race is on for that third place position.
McMullen has the lead. Pyra alongside is second. Sorensen is third. Netto is fourth. Holman's out of it. In the final meters, McMullen in front. Pyra there. Sorensen battling. Here comes Netto. It will be close, and the final spot will go to Netto, who falls. Following up on his U.S. championship last year and a trip to the World Championships, he'll be coming back to Atlanta to the Olympics. Here's McMullen.
My hometown of Cadillac made going to the Olympics the greatest thing that could ever happen to a person. On the 4th of July, they planned a press conference, a parade, a key to the city presentation, and a workout. The workout done at my high school track drew 5,000 people, and the workout began with a sub 4-minute mile. After the workout, we ran 2 miles through the streets with kids following me to the city park, where the mayor presented me with the key to the city. Getting dressed for opening ceremonies was like getting dressed to get married. Putting on the uniform was like putting on my tux. It was the moment where my dream met with reality. I was grateful for the path of my journey.
In 1996, Paul McMullen had his greatest athletic moment, qualifying for the U.S. Olympic team. A year later, his career was almost taken away during a freak accident. While cutting his neighbor's lawn, McMullen severed two of his toes. A matter of seconds caused him to rededicate his career.
I looked down at my foot after that accident and said, this could be it. This could be over right now, that quick. I said, this is a chance to watch your sport go on without you in it, and decide whether or not you're going to be able to contribute in the future. And that refreshes your motivation, definitely.
It is
is a great heartwarming story. Paul McMullen is the U.S. indoor champion at 1 mile. Tied at 355.84, his personal best. Here was the decisive moment as he went up to take the lead. The fastest time by an American this year, Paul McMullen.
Overcoming the injury to my foot was just another chapter in the pursuit of answering the question, how good can I be? I wanted to find out what a person could do when he decided to train his body to do what it should, not what it wanted. That decision happened on January 1st, 2001, as many other people make their New Year's resolutions. They say the mile is the perfect story, not too long that we get bored, and it's just long enough to build suspense for a surprise ending. The race was in doubt until the last couple of feet, where I edged out the guy in third to earn a spot on the 2001 World Championship team. The picture at the finish really captures the effort. Once I qualified for the World Championships, the next step was to prepare my body to challenge the best in the world. I spent 3 weeks training at home, supporting our newest family member, and fine-tuning my gift for running. Racing in the preliminaries, I had to use all of my skill and experience to negotiate a place in the final. In fact, the last two laps of the semifinal were run in a blistering 1 minute and 50 seconds. The World Championship final is a rare place for an American. The African countries dominate the middle distance races, and for a tall, bulky athlete from Cadillac, Michigan, stepping to the line was an accomplishment I savored. I gave all I had to finish 10th among the best in the world. Finding out the answer to my question was the reason behind all of my training and all of my sacrifices. I knew I had found out how fast I could run with the gift God gave me. I found I could run 3 minutes and 49 seconds for a mile. I found out I could make an Olympic team. I found I could place 10th in the world twice. We produced this video as proof that nearly impossible things are possible. I was a 210-pound high school football player that transformed himself into America's number one miler 4 times. I also recovered from losing 2 toes in a lawnmower accident to only run faster. And finally, I was a kid with a dream that worked hard when nobody was watching and came through to win when everybody was. I dare you to go after something others thought could not be done. I dare you to make a difference in this world. I dare you to run.
Welcome to the planet. Welcome to existence. Everyone's here. Everyone's here. Everybody's watching. The tension is here between us.